What could be the reason of the bad visual outcomes after cataract surgery or refractive lens exchange? And what you as a patient could do prior to the surgery to avoid that mistake and to get the best visual outcomes after the surgery? Hi there, my name is Alexey and you're at the IOL-adviser channel telling the truth about intraocular lenses. Between 30 to let's say 80 centimeters from our eyes sometimes have more significant impact even than visual acuity to functional vision of a human.
It is a real problem.
In order to improve your contrast sensitivity right after the surgery.
Today we have such a lens, taking PureSee.
And let me show you some interesting data which I gathered for you. The bad visual outcomes after the surgery have, I would say, three main reasons. The first one is purely clinical reasons or medical reasons. It is something related to eye health status of the patient before the surgery. For example, if a patient has a glaucoma or retinal issues or macular issues or something like that, it's something which definitely will impact visual outcomes with any intraocular lenses after the surgery. It is something you cannot avoid. Also, sometimes clinical issues after the cataract surgery may appear, but quite often they are not related to neither crystal lens or intraocular lens or to the surgery itself. It just happens with time, and sometimes it's by mistake could be associated with the surgery. But anyway, these clinical reasons is something you cannot avoid, and you are not able to influence these reasons. So we just talk about this, understand this, and let's keep it for now. The second reason is, so I would say, technical issues related to intraocular lens power calculation and the surgery itself. Honestly, I can tell you that type of problems happens quite rarely. However, even the best in the class, the most experienced surgeons could experience time to time these type of issues. It's something you may experience quite rarely, but as a patient, you are not able to influence all these issues. Probably only one point where you as a patient may influence, I would say, quality of intraocular lens power calculation is just following your doctor's prescriptions. Especially it is related to contact lens wearers. If before the surgery your doctor said to you, don't wear your contact lenses 2 weeks before we measure your eye for IOL power calculation, do it and don't try to cheat the doctor. If you are talking about rigid contact lenses, it should be 3 weeks. 2 weeks for soft contact lenses, 3 weeks for rigid contact lenses. It's very important for IOL power calculation, for its precision. And third group of reasons, it is visual acuity and visual quality after the surgery. And in this domain, you are able to influence your visual outcomes. So let me explain where and how. I would like to share with you a part of my presentation, which I did with a professional audience during the biggest ophthalmic surgical congress in Ukraine, Ophthalmic Hub 2025. Which I did this month for Ukrainian surgeons. And despite it's made for professional audience, I guess that the part which I'm going to share with you is quite simple to understand even for non-professional audience. And moreover, I will add some comments explaining parts of that presentation. And of course, if something will be still unclear to you, feel free to write me in the comments below and I will be happy to explain you to the best of my knowledge. Well, let's start from the very beginning. It is a visual acuity. Normally, we are talking about the visual acuity at far distance and we measure it at far in the ophthalmologist's office room, and we are talking about visual acuity 20/20 or 6/6 or something like that. It is a visual acuity at far distance. However, during our life, daily life, we need our vision at different distances. Standard basic monofocal intraocular lenses are not able to provide you with a good visual acuity between 30 to let's say 80 centimeters from our eyes. And for that reason, sometimes your doctor may offer you so-called monovision or special setup of the monofocal intraocular lenses to aid you an ability to see up close quite good.
And what is monovision? As all of you know, the monovision is a kind of alternative to achieve vision without compromises between near and far and night vision quality. And of course, thanks to Professor Lutsenko and Dr. Kovalev, we had a good discussion about monovision, because it also has its limitations. Nothing is perfect.
Well, I hope it is more or less clear for you, if you're already familiar with some videos on my channel. And what is important, to my opinion, talking about the full monovision in 2025 doesn't make any sense, because we have advanced monofocal or enhanced range of vision intraocular lenses, so-called EDOF technology, even if you are not touching the trifocal or full range of vision lenses.
And having a basic monovision with basic monofocal IOLs had a lot of sense a few years ago, but now it makes no sense, as now we have an enhanced monofocal lenses for mini monovision and modern EDOF or extended range of vision lenses for micro monovision if clinically indicated or desirable by the patient.
Many years ago we didn't have intraocular lenses which was able to provide you with good visual acuity at that range. So let me remind you shortly the story of that segment of elongated range of focus, increased range of focus lenses.
Now let's get back to EDOF IOLs. The EDOF segment has been created in 2014 by J&J with a Symphony lens. This lens is well known to you and it has a diffractive HLA design and was sometimes mistakenly seen as multifocal lens. It is not true, and we talked about it a lot of times, it's purely EDOF lens just based on diffractive technology. And then 5 years later, the era of non-diffractive technology somehow began in 2019, also by J&J, when they launched the Technis Eyhance. But I want to note, Eyhance is not an EDOF lens in the sense of criteria defined by AAO or ESRS. It is enhanced monofocal lens. However, the internal technology is EDOF based. The first true non-diffractive EDOF lens was created by Alcon, a well-known Alcon VVT lens, which we know since 2020s. With its X-wave technology, well visible in the central optics, which is a core element that refracts the light into a single elongated focal point. And then in 2024, Johnson & Johnson released Technis PureSee, a fully refractive lens using a completely different technology with no visible optical elements. We'll discuss it in details shortly.
Nowadays, having enhanced monofocal lenses like Technis Eyhance or extended range vision lenses based on EDOF technologies, we may use mini monovision or micro monovision, which eliminates the drawbacks of the full monovision and elongates our, let's say, visual distance or depth of good visual acuity across the range. I cannot tell that micro monovision is the best technology nowadays. Any technology or any intraocular lenses has its own drawbacks, benefits or, let's say, weakness. Just for you to understand the different options, what you can discuss with your doctor. Well, I guess now you have a better understanding of visual acuity across a different range and different options, which you may use for increased visual acuity, improved visual acuity at near, intermediate and far for sure. And what is more important and what I would like to talk to you about other aspect, about other characteristic of the visual quality of your visual system after the surgery, it is something which is called contrast sensitivity. It's quite often underestimated because we don't use it, we don't measure it quite routinely in our ophthalmic practice. But according to newer publications, according to modern visual needs of the modern patients, contrast sensitivity sometimes have more significant impact even than visual acuity to functional vision of a human.
And third, possibly the most underestimated yet most critical for functional vision is the contrast sensitivity. We need to discuss contrast sensitivity in more details because in many real-life situations it's more important for human functioning than the visual acuity. It is a number of publications available supporting that claim. For example, a well-known publication of 1987, which I'll refer to later today, or newer publication from 2022 or 2023 in the literature. Driving, facial recognition, signs, emotions all rely on contrast sensitivity under low contrast conditions. There are two parts. The patient's subjective contrast sensitivity and the model transfer function or MTF of the optics. A patient's contrast sensitivity depends on many factors. Corneal condition, tear film, retina, axial lens, vitreous, optic nerve, visual cortex, etc. And of course it depends on the intraocular lens. Because if we'll take two identical patients, whether healthy or with some retinal glaucoma issues doesn't matter. However, they should be absolutely identical and under the same conditions. And implants them two different IOLs, one with a lower MTF and one with a higher MTF, the patient will have a better contrast sensitivity with a higher MTF lens. So let's recall what is MTF of modulation transfer function. Briefly, MTF describes how optics transfer the fine details in contrast. If you look at the world around you, you will notice large objects like chairs. They are large and they have fewer elements per space, that is low spatial frequency. And fine details like texture of fabric have more elements per space or high spatial frequency. And all these frequencies have a different contrast. And we combined all this on one graph, an MTF. And on that graph, for example, one lens or optical system can transmit, for example, 40% of visual information at certain contrast and frequency level. and another lens can transmit only 20. Transmitting 100% of the contrast over all the frequencies is physically impossible. It's an optics limitation. So, MTF essentially merges resolution and contrast into one metric. As you can see, this image top left is crisp, detailed and highly contrasted. Bottom, less defined, blurry. And when we think about the contrast loss, we often imagine such type of images. But that's wrong. Importantly, we have to understand that contrast sensitivity loss is actually the loss of image details or entire visual elements, entire elements of the image in the shadows. And this is explained by the spatial vision theory, a critical element to in understanding how do we see the world. It's also the principle behind the digital cameras. Your phone camera works based on this principle. Briefly, the idea is the following. Visual information consists of elemental sinusoidal patterns with varying orientation, brightness and spatial frequency. All the information we see is decompressed into those elemental patterns. Then, in cameras, mathematical Fourier transformations recompose the image from these pieces to the whole picture. And in the human visual system, similar computations happen, not like a phone, like a camera, but conceptually very close. These transformations rebuild the picture from the elements into a whole picture which we see and perceive. Like in this face example. First, we just see a person, and then magic happens. Our brain combines the high contrast and large objects with low contrast and fine details into complete perceived image. And we see a person and recognize the emotions. So, important point is that contrast loss means loss of details, or even entire components, especially in the shadows. Because if the one part of that mathematical equation is lost, you lose more than one small detail. Something like on the picture I'm showing you now. The picture I'm showing you is from this interesting work published in 1987 by Arthur Ginsburg. It's available online. In that publication, all these factors, especially related to ophthalmology, are well explained. So, when we're thinking about losing contrast sensitivity or losing contrast, we imagine a slightly lower contrast images. And we think, well, it's not good, but it's okay to live with. It's nothing special. But not. It's about unrealistic images when the part of the image or entire low contrast details or low contrast object are in the shadow that may disappear from the patient's perception, like pedestrian on a dark road or like emotions on the face. It is a real problem.
As you can see now, contrast sensitivity is a very important factor in your visual outcomes, in your visual quality after the surgery, especially in the dim light conditions or low contrast environment like fog, rain, dusk, whatever. And here is a question mark. What you can do as a patient in order to improve your contrast sensitivity right after the surgery? Honestly, after the surgery, there is not so much room for improvement. However, before the surgery, you definitely can influence your visual outcomes after the surgery by selecting the intraocular lenses which has a better contrast transmission than others. And let me show you some interesting data which I gathered for you.
Today we have such a lens, Technis PureSee, a fully refractive lens we talked about yesterday. And contrast sensitivity. With PureSee, contrast sensitivity is comparable and almost identical to Eyehance. But let's recall what Eyehance gives in terms of optics. We said everything is fine, but let's compare. Maybe Eyehance isn't as perfect as we think. Here's an official bench testing data from J&J. It's publicly available. They have tested various lenses. As you can see here, Eyehance has a slightly lower MTF than the basic Technis monofocal. But in wide pupil and low light conditions, it performs 31% better than standard monofocal lens including Alcon Clarion. That means better contrast sensitivity potentially overall. And what about PureSee? The same test, optical comparison with the similar lenses. Big difference here, PureSee versus Vivity, especially 36% better in low light. Again, it's about the giving a patient more contrast, better visual quality, better vision with more details. Next, this part is personal. I'm planning a refractive lens exchange due to my hyperopia. And well, I wanted to compare the both worlds, which I believe no one has been done yet. I compare MTF on the same scale with monofocal and EDOF lens. Eyehance, PureSee, Vivity and monofocal Clarion. And have a look at this magic. In low light, where all compromises and all the issues of presbyopia correcting IOLs are well noticeable, with a 5mm pupil, monofocal Clarion performs slightly worse than presbyopic PureSee. That's amazing.
As you can see now, having more detailed information about intraocular lenses may influence your visual outcomes after the surgery. And despite that PureSee is not available in the United States nowadays yet, I believe it will be available quite soon. And now in the United States you have a beautiful lens Technis Odyssey, which provides you similar modulation transfer function similar to Technis PureSee with a very high quality contrast sensitivity transmission. And also you have a Technis Eyhance, which provides even better contrast, however way shorter depth of field, way shorter visual acuity across the range.
So what does it mean to me? First, personally it inspires me. Second, 61% of patients want to see without glasses. Please remember that, and I hope it will inspire you. Now we have a PureSee, the good range of vision. Not as wide as Synergy, but with no nighttime visual effects. No contrast loss in low light conditions comparing to well-known monofocals.
So you have a lot of options if there is no medical issues, no contraindications to improve your contrast sensitivity and to improve your functional vision after the surgery.